Okay, so we're going to get into the idea of linear independence. So this is like one of your theoretical concepts, linear algebra here. The first thing we need to understand is what we mean by a linear combination. Okay, so I'm going to say I have some vector v in V, where V plus is a vector space. Okay. And I got a bunch of vectors. So let's say I have a vector, we'll call it u1, u2, and we'll have a finite number out to uk, and that these are also in V, right? And I know that V is some constant times u1 plus some constant times u2 out to some constant times uk, then we say that V is a linear combination of the vectors V u1, u2 out to UK. So if I can somehow combine these using addition and scalar multiplication to get V, then V is considered a linear combination of the other ones. Okay, so we're going to get into a little bit of a technical idea here for a little bit, and then we're going to dive right back out of it, but we're going to get this idea of spanning. Okay, so what do I know? What do I call a spanning set? Okay. So I have some set S. It has a bunch of vectors, v1, v2, to vk. And this is a subset, not an element, a subset of V. And all right, so let's say that I've got that, and then I also know that if V is in V, so another vector V is in V, then there exists C1, C2 out to CK, right? Such that I can actually make V by linearly combining these other vectors, right? C1, V1, C2, V2, out to CK, VK. All right, so if you give me any vector in V and I can make a linear combination of these vectors, then we say that S spans V. Or another way of saying this is that the span of S is V. Okay, so that every single vector in V can be made as a linear combination of the things in S. So this gives me a way to talk about the vector space without having to know every single vector that's in it. I just have to know the ones that I need to be able to span. Okay, so one of the things that would be really nice would be if this spanning set is actually what do you call it? Sorry, if the span of S is actually a vector subspace of V, right? So let's kind of get that to work out here. Okay, so let me add some clarity to what we're saying here. Let's say I have a set S, right? And S is comprised of a finite set of vectors. Okay, and that sub is a subset of V, which is a vector space. Okay, what I want to show is that the span of S, even if S, the span of S is going to be some subset of V. It doesn't have to be all of V, right? If the span of S is some subset of V, I want to show that the span of S is a vector subspace of V. Okay, so what do I have to do in order to show this? Okay, and in fact, later on, we're going to see that the span of S is the minimal vector subspace of V that contains the vectors in S, but we'll get to that a little bit later on. So, in order to show that the span of S is a vector subspace of the whole space V, this is pretty straightforward. We have to show that we are closed under addition and scalar multiplication. So if U is an element of the span of S, then I can build a linear combination of the elements of S in order to make U, because that's what S means to, that's what it means to be in the span of S. Those shouldn't be threes. Those should be k's, right? So I can build a linear combination to get u, which means that this is in the span of S. If I create a second one, v, then I will also be able to create a linear combination, just the coefficients will be different. Okay, so this is also in the span of S. Well, if I take u plus v, well, then I'm just going to get C1 plus D1 times V1 and C2 plus D2 times V2 out to CK plus DK times VK, which means that this is in the span of S because it's a linear combination of V1, V2 out to VK. So this means I'm closed under addition. And then if I take some constant times u, I'm going to get c times c1 v1 plus c times c2 times v2 out to c times ck times vk, which again, this is just a set of coefficients times the things in S, which means that this is part of the span of S. So if I'm closed under addition and closed under scalar multiplication, I now that know that the span of S is a vector subspace of V. All right, so that proves that theorem, right? So the spanning set has to be the vector subspace of the vector space that it's in. So that got a little technical and heavy. We're going to back away from that for a little bit. We will come back to that idea of spanning and minimal spanning sets when we get into bases. But for right now, we're just going to kind of make a small swerve away from that. And we're going to get into this major idea of called linear independence. Okay. So, in order to understand linear independence, we're going to create some set S and we're going to give it some vectors v1, v2, and bring it to vk. So, it is a finite number of vectors. Okay. And it's going to be a subset of V, which is also going to be a vector space, right? All right. So, if I have this such that now, I'm going to take a bunch of coefficients. So I'm going to build a linear combination of the things in S. And I'm going to set that equal to the zero vector. Then, if, so this is like such that if this is equal to zero, if and only if C1 is equal to C2 is equal to CK is equal to zero. Okay, so what's going on here? I'm saying that this thing, the only way that I can get the zero vector by combining these vectors is if all the coefficients are zero. If that's the case, then we say S is linearly independent. Okay. Otherwise, We say that loss S is linearly dependent. Now, in a minute, what we're going to show here is that if I'm linearly independent, I cannot build any of the vectors in S by combining the other vectors in S. But that's a little bit cumbersome to prove that. So what we do is we start with this really simple idea that if I can combine them and get the zero vector, then the combination can only happen if all the coefficients is zero. That gets me the idea of linear independence. Okay. So linear dependence means that I can combine them in some other way. All right. So this is a little abstract. I'm going to put this to some specific examples and see if we can't get there from here. All right. So let's make S a set of three vectors. Let's make it the vector 1, 2, 3, the vector 0, 1, 1, 2, and the vector negative 1 or negative 2, 0, 1. Okay, and the argument here is that this is a linearly independent set. So we're going to call this one V1, we'll call this one V2, we'll call this one V3. Okay, so how do we prove that this is linearly independent? Well, we say we're going to take some constant times 1, 2, 3, plus some other constant times 0, 1, 2, times a third constant times negative 2, 0, 1, and we're going to set that equal to 0, 0, 0. Okay, so I can decompose this a bit and build a system of equations. So C1 plus 0 C2s minus 2 C3s should equal 0. 2 C1s plus 1 C2 plus 0 3 C3 should equal 0. 3 C1s plus 2 C2s plus 1 C3 should also equal 0. If this statement here is true, then this system of equations has to hold. Now, this is a perfect job for Gauss-Jordan, right? So we build our augmented matrix. 1, 0, negative 1, 0. 2, 1, 0, 0. 3, 2, 1, 0. So this is a homogeneous system of equations. We take our REF, and lo and behold, we get 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that this has a unique solution, namely that C1 has to equal C2, has to equal C3, which all have to equal 0. So this means I am linearly independent. That these three vectors are linearly independent. Now, in a little bit, we're going to prove that you cannot build any one of these vectors by taking a linear combination of the other two. But this gives me this idea of linear independence. Okay, will this work with any set of three vectors? No. Okay, so let's work with polynomials here. So my first one is going to be 1 plus x plus 2, oop, not plus, minus 2x squared. Okay. And then we have 2 plus 5x minus x squared. And we have x plus x squared. So this is three polynomials that are degree 2 or less, right? So this is the vector space P2. We'll call this one P1. We'll call this one P2. We'll call this one P3, right? So, what's the first thing we do? We take C times P1, C1 times P1 plus C2 times P2 plus C3 times P3, and we should get the zero polynomial, which would be 0 plus 0x plus 0x squared. Okay, So if I do this, I have C1 times 1 plus x minus 2x squared plus C2 times 2 plus 5x minus x squared plus C3 times x plus x squared. And I want that to be equal to 0 plus 0x plus 0x squared. All right, so this is again going to yield a system of equations because 1c1 plus 2c2s plus 0c3s should equal 0. 1c1 plus 5c2s plus 1c3 should equal 0, and negative 2c1s minus 1c2 plus 1c3 should also equal 0. So the augmented matrix here becomes 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 5, 1, 0, negative 2, negative 1, 1, 0. See how it, like, even though we started with a completely different type of object here, it all just like boils down to the same type of matrix. Now, if I perform Gauss-Jordan on that, I get an interesting result. I get 1, 2, 0. That doesn't look good. 0, 1, 1/3, 0, and then a row of zeros, which means that I have a free variable, right? So ultimately, this does not have a unique solution. It has a solution, there's a whole bunch of them. As an infinite number, right? Zero is always equal to zero, so I have an underdetermined system. So in the end of the day here, I have a solutions that are not just 0, 0, 0, 0. So this is not linearly independent, so we say that this is linearly dependent. And if you work hard enough, you're going to be able to see that you can actually combine this polynomial and that polynomial linearly and get that one. All right, so like what would I have to have? Like, I don't know, I want negative 2x squared, right? So I have, so I think if I multiply this through by negative 1, maybe. Let's see, negative 1 plus that. I don't know. I have to do a little bit of thinking. But at some point here, I can create a linear combination that's going to cause that to happen. All right. So let's keep moving forward a little bit here. All right, so what are we talking about here in this proof? So we get a bit of a theorem, right? It tells me that S is some set V1, V2, out to VK, right? And K has to be greater than or equal to 2, or this doesn't make sense. We're going to say that this is linearly dependent if and only if there exists some VJ, which is an element of S, such that VJ is a linear combination V1 plus C2 V2 plus CJ minus 1 VJ minus 1 plus CJ plus 1 VJ plus 1 out to CK VK. So if we take VJ out and I make a linear combination of the other things in S, then I can make VJ by combining the other things in FS linearly. All right, so let's see if we can actually prove that this is true. So it's if and only if. So I have to prove it going both ways. I have to prove that linearly dependence implies that the combination can be made, and that if the combination can be made, that I have shown linear dependence. Okay, so let's start the proof going this way first. So how do we do this? We start with the idea that we're linearly dependent, right? So we let C1 V1, right, plus C2 V2 out to, or we're going to prove linear dependence, right? No, take that back. We're going to start with linear dependence. CK VK is equal to 0. Okay. Without loss of generality, at least one of these things has to be, what do you call it? Non-zero. Okay. Since the V's are not in any particular order, without loss of generality, I can let C1 not equal to 0. Okay. So this comes from being linear dependent. So if that's the case, then C1 V1 is equal to negative C2 V2 plus out to CK VK, right? Those are not pluses. Those are now minuses because I've brought them to the other side of the world there, right? So minus C3 V3 minus CK VK. Okay, so we've brought everything just to the other side. Then V1 has to equal negative C2 over C1. Because it's non-zero, I can do that division. Minus C3 over C1 V3 minus CK over C1 VK. And there we have it. We've shown that I can build V1 out of a linear combination of the other vectors. So without loss of generality, it didn't have to be V1. I could have done this with some other vector, but the order of the vectors is inconsequential because S is not an ordered set. All right, so now I got to go the other way. So now assume that V1 can be a combination of the other vectors, right? So now we got to get back to linear independence, right? So what do we got here? We have this. Well, if I bring V1 to the other side, I can say that negative V1 plus C2 V2 plus C3 V3 plus CK VK is the zero vector. But lo and behold, C1 is equal to negative one. There it is, right? Which means that I don't have all the C's equaling to zero when the linear combination is zero. So I am linearly dependent. So this theorem tells me that if I have a linearly dependent set, then I can take a combination of the vectors and get another vector that's in the set. Now, the flip of that, because it's biconditional, if and only if, means that if it's linearly independent, I cannot do that. All right, so there's your notes on the theory of linear independence, and we'll look at how that ties to things like the determinant and the identity matrix and all of this a little bit there. You probably could see some hints of that as we were going along.